Grab your sticks, drummers, because today we're going to learn how to play Australia's national anthem. What's up, drummers? Damien here. And, well, you'd be hard-pressed to find a more iconic song that is more commonly requested in any bar around Australia than the one we're going to look at today. So the song is Khe Sanh by Cold Chisel. If you are Australian, you will already know this song and you will already know this band. They are pretty much one of the most popular bands ever recorded in Australia, and this song is really one of their hit songs. It was written by the pianist, a guy by the name of Don Walker, played by on drums by a gentleman named Steve Prestwich, who unfortunately died in 2011. But this song was recorded way back in 1978, and it talks about a returned Vietnam vet who just has trouble fitting back into civilian life when he returns. It's hard to say really what everybody loved about this song or has grown to love about this song, but a lot of people have sort of joked, as I did at the beginning of this video, that it's really Australia's national anthem. It is so well known and loved, and you're going to be hard pressed to go to a bar as a musician and not have this song requested night after night. It really is that popular. And so if you're in a cover band, you're going to need to know how to play it. So if you haven't already, go and get the link in the description there, click on it and download the transcription, which you should now see on the screen. And we're going to walk through the different parts of the song. Now, this song is not complex in terms of the parts themselves. And in fact, if you've been watching my video series on how to read drum notation, you will already have the knowledge to be able to see everything and play everything that's going to appear on this piece of music. But it's quite quick. So it's at 164 beats a minute, and if you're playing eighth notes, which you will be for the majority of this song, it's going to get very tiring if you're really laying into them and giving them a lot of force and effort. That's not what we want for this song. If you listen to the song, you'll notice that it's actually sort of almost a country rock feel. It drives quite well, but as far as the drumming's concerned, it's very complementary to the music. It's not really pushing through. In actual fact, it was quite difficult to even hear some of the drum parts because it's very, it's lively, but it's very delicate as well. It's not driven with a lot of force like a lot of hard rock music is today. Okay, but again, the tempo is 164 beats a minute. Flipping back to the document here, what I've done in the top right-hand corner, and hopefully anybody who transcribes a piece of music will do this, I've put the legend at the top corner just so you can see all the different parts of the kit that we're going to require to play this song and where they're all being represented on the staff. This isn't always the same for drums, unfortunately, so it's quite handy when you do have that legend. Anyway, the beginning of the song starts with quite a long intro, singing and piano, but by the time the drums come in, what we see a lot of is this beat which I'm highlighting now. So it's a basic rock beat. You've got a bass drum on one, snare drum on two, bass drums on two and three, and then a snare and four. So it has a one, two and three, four, one, two and three, four, right? It's got that sort of flavor to it. Now, the bass drum on two and it can be optional, but it's certainly not as loud as the bass drum on three. So you have this effect where you're sort of falling into the count on three. So it does have a very solid one, two, three, four drive about it, but there's that bass drum on the two end, which is just sort of hinting at the bass drum on three, if that makes sense. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to cut to a clip of playing this beat. First of all, we're going to do it slow. So we're going to look at it at 82 beats a minute, yeah, exactly half speed. Play that through a couple of times, and then we're going to hear the same thing again up to speed at 164. So as I said, the tempo can be a little bit demanding, but moving on, The next step we see is these strange little symbols, which I should probably just clarify what they are. Whenever you see that symbol there, what it means is you need to repeat the measure that you've just played. Okay, so this beat that we looked at first of all, that has the kick on the two and the three, what we're doing is actually repeating that beat over and over and over again. Now, why didn't I go and write that out every single time? Well, there's a few reasons. First of all, it puts more notes on the page, which makes things look a little bit more complicated and a little bit harder to read, especially at first glance. But the other thing is too, if you are able to simplify your notation as much as possible, then what you're left with, what you write out fully or translate fully, is really the exceptions to what's going on. So when you look at a sheet of paper like this one here, really the only notes that are appearing to you are the notes where something in the song changes or is different to everything else that you're expecting to play in the song. Okay, and that makes it easy to pick up a piece of music like this and learn it quickly, because you're just looking for those exceptions to learn and sort of indicate where the changes are in the music. And one thing that the drummer did a lot was to actually turn this particular pattern into a four-bar phrase. And what that means is he would play three bars exactly the same way, but then the final bar or measure, he would put an extra bass drum in. So you sort of have this four-measure round robin where it keeps repeating every four bars. And so what I'm referring to is this here. Now, there's a little open hi-hat which sort of changes the beat again, but essentially you're playing one, two, and three, four. So you're doing that three times. You're doing it two times. One, two, and three, four. One, two, and three, four. Then you play one, two, and three, four, and one, two, and three, four. So the whole pattern is one, two, and three, four. One, two, and three, four. One, two, and three, four, and one, two, and three, four. Repeat. So I'm going to cut to a clip of playing that now. First of all, once again, slowly and then sped up. Okay, so now that we've learnt the bulk of the rhythms that we're going to require to put this song together, we're really left now with the drum fills. And the first drum fill we really see comes in on the measure of 101. So if I clip over now, you can see here's measure number 101. And what we have is what appears to be, at least, the same beat that we've been playing, but there's a little change at the end, and it's really just one tom, and then we're into the solo. Now, another thing to note, or two things to note really. First of all, it's very common to have a crash when we transition out of a fill into a new section of a song. We won't be doing that in this case, so you can clearly see that when we get to the count of four and go into the solo section, there's no crash there. But the next point to make is that we are actually moving onto the ride cymbal at this point. So we come off the hi-hats, play the tom as the drum fill, and then we move straight over into the ride, entering the solo. So let's have a bit of a look, once again, slow and fast, how this sounds. Okay, looking now at bar 116, We have a crash on the count of four, and then after the crash, we have a rest on one. This can trip people up, so be careful. And then we have snare and floor tom. Now this is building as eighth notes, okay? So you don't want to attack it too quickly to begin with. It's like a rising sound. Moving down to bar number 133 now. This is a fairly simple little drum fill here. Given the speed of the song, you could probably use two hands. So you will play the standard beat, one and two and three. You'll have a right hand on the hi-hat. And then what you could actually do is bring the right hand over. So the counts of three and, four and could be played with a left hand, a right hand, and a left hand. Alright, now we get to what is undoubtedly the most difficult drum fill of the entire song. And you see it at bar number 149. Here it is here. And normally when you get to these types of drum fills, it's best to just break them down bit by bit and work through them. So it's all on the snare drum, which is good. We have a count of one, then two, one and is the snare with a hi-hat. Two is also a snare with the hi-hat, so this is two hands together. And then the right hand will come over and we're into a snare roll. So that snare roll begins on the count of two and. So it's two and up, then three E and up, four E and up. So the full rhythm there is one and two and up, three E and up, four E and up. And the hand pattern itself would be kick drum, together, together, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left. Okay, now unfortunately the fun doesn't stop there, because immediately after that drum fill, what you see is that we go back to the hi-hats for the count of one, then we have an accent with a crash and a snare on two, and then we're over on the ride. So part of the challenge, of course, is learning this drum fill. The other challenge, of course, is coming out of this drum fill over to the ride and continuing on, all without skipping a beat. The very last drum fill in this song appears in bar number 163, and it's fairly simple. It's just a flam on the count of four, and then we approach the outro, or the very end of the song. You can see that RIT, which is basically an indication that this is slowing down. It's pretty much free time at this point, but you know, just a gradual slowdown of the metronome. You'll hear it in the song anyway. So yeah, drum fill on four, and then you're on your way out of the song, and we are done. Okay, so we're now at the end of the song, and if you followed along this far, you should be able to now put the song on, put the headphones on, and play along with the track. I'm going to do that now just for my own enjoyment. Just a quick thing to note, this transcription that I've gone through today is really my interpretation of what I'm hearing when I listen back to the original song. As I may have said, it's a little bit difficult to hear every little piece, and so sometimes you have to sort of interpret what you're hearing and make it your own. And that's what I've done. So when I play through this song now, you'll notice that there may be a bass drum here and there that maybe isn't notated, or maybe there should be something in there that isn't there. But that's all part of the process of transcribing songs and learning songs. And as any performing musician will know, when you get out on stage and play this stuff, it always comes out a little bit different week to week. And that's not a bad thing. It's actually the precursor, or what helps you build your own style down the track. Get behind the kit, put the song on, have some fun, and I'll see you on the next walkthrough. She was lying and I was home to the lucky land.